Good morning. This is Jason Dean again, coming live at you again. It is about 10:53 on a Friday morning. It's December 1st already. It's hard to believe we are here at December 1st already. It's crazy, but going by quick. Santa Claus is gearing up for another season, I'm sure. So yeah, I did a video this morning on one of the greatest vampire movies ever made. And the one and only Blade, the original Blade, with Wesley Snipes. So I'm about to upload that, so check that out if you get a chance. So hope everyone's doing good and has some fun plans for the weekend. Tonight we're playing at Hey Sailor with Quantum, which is a really amazing place in Searsport. Brand new venue, so pretty excited about that. We'll see how things go. The other thing I might do this weekend, which I want to really try to go, I'm not sure which day I'm going to do it, but I really want to see it. There's a new Godzilla movie out, Godzilla Minus One, and it's the latest Japanese, and I believe Toho Studio original, and it just looks amazing, and I've heard some really good things about it, and I was super excited that it's actually playing in the theaters, and so it's playing right in Waterville, so I'm gonna try my damnedest to either go Saturday or Sunday to go see that. I'm a huge, huge Godzilla fan. I'm not a big fan. I kind of think most of the American versions kind of are all trash. I liked the last one, one of the last ones that had come out that was an American movie. I kind of liked that movie, but now I'm just like, I don't really like that movie anymore. I'm when it comes to the Japanese culture, one of the things that I love so much about it is Toho. And I am a huge fan of all of the old school Godzilla films. And I think that, you know, the last one that they did, Shin Godzilla, is just amazing. So this is the first one since then. And that movie is just so badass. So I'm really excited. And so we'll see. We'll see. Fingers crossed. And if I see it, I will definitely do a review on Godzilla. I don't have any real reviews of any Godzilla movies, which is a crying shame because such a huge fan of that stuff growing up. So stay tuned. There will be a show about that at some point, probably around the review of Godzilla Minus One, if I get to go see it this weekend, which I'm going to try my damnedest. So again, with Film Fanatic and this channel and kind of the format that I have, I try to mix things up and do some specialty shows and try to not only talk about, you know, the films themselves, but things that are directly related to that, you know, doing some shows on film scores and soundtracks, particular directors that I really love. I've also talked about, you know, kind of the dilemma of where we're at with social media, streaming and physical, physical content, all those things. So this is a different show, another specialty show that is definitely directly related to, you know, all things movies. And I also think it's a topic or a situation that really runs deep or cuts very deep. And recently, it was in the recent press, just happened, I think, a couple of weeks ago. But the two lead actresses from the Scream franchise, Jenna Ortega, and especially Melissa Barrera, who was they are both in the Scream franchise. I guess they were both in the last two Scream films. I've heard of those movies. I've only seen a few of them, and I do like them. I love the first one to death. I'm a huge Wes Craven fan. I haven't really seen the other movies, though. I don't know why. I just haven't, but one of these days I will, and I've heard that they're all really good for the most part. And so I'm definitely at some point going to check them out. But anyway, the last two films, I think they're at 7 now. The last two films, I believe, from what I was reading, the two lead actresses, Jenna Ortega and Melissa Barrera, are basically spearheading the franchise. And those movies, I know as a franchise, and those last two movies, especially the last one, were very successful in the box office. there's a huge following, you know, a huge fan base for the Scream franchise. And so, you know, the thing that I loved about the first one is how, you know, how it breaks down the third wall. It's kind of meta, and it really has a real interesting take and narrative on horror films and just how, you know, we kind of perceive horror movies and how we interact with movies. And then, so I always thought it had a really cool thing about it. It had a great use of comedy and horror and jump scares, like using jump scares in a really effective way. And I remember seeing the first Scream in the theater, and I thought it was great. I remember it being generally scary and frightening, especially the opening sequence in that movie with Drew Barrymore. Like, that's a really fucking intense scene. And I love the humor and the satire aspect of the film, you know, and the whole meta thing about the film. It's just great, but... But again, I just haven't seen the franchise. But I saw this story recently, just the other day. And at first it started with the news of Melissa Barrera being fired from Scream. And from what I've been reading, the last two films were very successful commercially. And a lot of fans regard these two actresses as being kind of the main faces of the film of the Scream franchise and kind of the biggest attraction right now. And I heard that their performances, and I haven't seen either of these films, and they're on my list, but they are, you know, looked at or regarded as, you know, kind of the main draw for the film and the franchise. And it was announced that they're making an eighth film. So, and that they're looked at as this next generation for this franchise, and you know, they're kind of moving it forward, and they're very popular actresses. But it was announced recently that Melissa Barrera was fired from Scream, basically. Spyglass Media is the company that owns the franchise, and it was announced last week or the week before that she was going to be she was fired from the entire series. And it was kind of a shock. And the reason that she was being fired was because of some comments that she had made on Twitter in regards to the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. And she was accused of basically that these statements that she made were anti-Semitic. So she was fired. And then shortly, I think within that week, Jenna Ortega, who's also her co-star, and I believe they play sisters in the movies, in the franchise, she also quit. She had quit the franchise. And the studio basically had said that it was because of scheduling conflict. But it was just weird timing of the whole thing. And this whole kind of story sent shockwaves, especially with the news of Jenna Ortega being fired for basically, you know, releasing a statement on Twitter where she was, the topic was the horrible, disgusting situation of, you know, what's been going on in that part of the world and has been going on for 30 to 50 years. And that she was accused of being anti-Semitic. So first and foremost, like, my reaction was, holy shit, like, what the hell's going on? So I remember, like most people, they were, you know, everybody was shocked and surprised. And so I checked it out. I checked out, you know, the actual articles, different articles. And I looked at, you know, her tweet that she had actually said. And she... more or less, well, there was absolutely nothing in her statement that was anti-Semitic, and she basically essentially called for a ceasefire, you know, and so, and evidently people calling for a ceasefire in this horrible situation, I guess that is, you know, an elephant in a room evidently, and is one of the worst things that someone can say. More or less, that's what she said. She didn't say anything at all inflammatory or at all that indicates that she's anti-Semitic in any way, shape, or form. And so she was fired. And so there was this whole thing about on one hand, you had people crying out about, well, this is like, you know, this is free speech. It's going to become a thing of the past. And then other people were saying, well, it's not a question of free speech. It's a question of, you know, businesses who, you know, businesses can have, car companies have the freedom to fire or to hire anybody they want. And if they don't agree with someone, you know, with who they are or what they say, they can just, they can distance themselves and not be part of, and they cannot be, you know, they will be asked to, they don't want to be associated with them. So they'll ask them to move on and whatnot. And the first thing that I thought about, well, the whole thing that would kick this whole idea around this whole thing for me was somebody I know on Facebook who I have actually, I do know him pretty well. We've corresponded quite a bit. But he's, you know, overall, I would have to say he's, like, I kind of consider myself to be a pretty progressive person, or like to think that I am. But I would say overall, he's pretty critical of both political parties, but he's definitely on the right-wing side of things. So, you know, he's a strange guy in a way of, like, sometimes I'm not sure how to take what he says, you know, whether he's being an agitator or he's just trying to be honest and speak his opinion, or he's just trying to get a headline, which is what happens in social media. So he's intentionally trying to throw things out there that he knows are going to, you know, set people off, which is, you know, part of the bullshit of Facebook and social media. Like, one of the things he had said was, you know, he was saying, well, like, you know, you can, a kid going to a football game who dresses up, like, say, for, you know, I don't know, the Washington Redskins. They were some kind of thing, supposedly a story of at a football game where a kid was dressed up with his family. He was dressed up as a Native American dressed up, you know, to go to this football game, but he was dressed up as a Native American. And supposedly that was that story was targeted as, you know, that's inappropriate. You know, that's basically racism and all this stuff. And then there was, but then he also said, you know, that's someone doing that is wrong. Like, that action is wrong. And that's inherently racist because of where we are with the whole, like, woke thing. And then he said at the same time, but yet it's acceptable for a guy to go around dressed up as a woman, and that's acceptable. And I'm just like, I don't know how to take that. Like, what is he trying to say? Is he, you know, is he being a total just dick, or is he, like, talking about something that is kind of imaginary, and if that's even a real story, or he's just completely a provocateur, or is he trying to, you know, be mean and hateful? And I think it's a combination of all those things. You know, so I don't know. But it's, but anyway, this, he had also made a statement on his Facebook page where he said, another very famous actress, Susan Sarandon, was just recently fired also from a project because of statements that she made, again, about the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. Again, I looked into that, and she basically was calling for a ceasefire. And so she was fired, you know, nothing resembling, there was nothing in her speech that she gave. And it wasn't even a formal speech she was giving. She was just kind of talking at this rally that they had in New York for the Palestinians. And so, she didn't say anything that was even remotely anti-Semitic. So she got fired. So this same guy that I mentioned said that, well, this is a great thing. This is awesome that she got fired. And I'm just like, what's wrong with people these days? And so this whole situation has reminded me of, basically, I feel like it's kind of the Dixie Chicks, that whole scenario that happened during the George W. Bush era. It's the same thing, just playing over again, playing itself over again. And it's all playing out the same way. It's a very different situation, I think, but it's basically the same scenario. Where in the whole, you know, famously, that was an infamous part of our history in the entertainment world. Dixie Chicks, you know, were two famous country stars that in the height of the Iraq War, they basically came out at a concert and had said that the war was, you know, based on lies, it was an atrocity, and they were very critical of George Bush. And they had said basically this during a concert somewhere. And so after that, all they faced, and during that climate, people were really seized by this idea of fear. And it was this shitstorm of fear that this country was in. And so people were still feeling the effects of 9/11, and all of these things were happening. So there was a huge backlash against the Dixie Chicks, including their corporate sponsors. So basically they were shut down. Every conceivable radio station stopped playing any of their music. I think their record label even dropped them. They were basically completely blacklisted, and their careers overnight, they were destroyed completely. And so this whole situation made me think of that same thing all over again. And it's been happening a lot. This same situation is playing itself over and over again. This whole Scream franchise is not like an isolated incident. I mean, you have, within weeks of this happening, Susan Sarandon was fired for the very same thing. And the other thing that's been going on for a little bit longer has been all the controversy around people trying to boycott and also ban Roger Waters from performing. Roger Waters, of course, from the iconic band Pink Floyd. And so there's been all of this controversy of him being accused also of being anti-Semitic and being, a pro-nationalist, white supremacist, basically. Because he's basically also done the same thing where he is, he's an influencer, he's a voice, he has an audience, and he has been very outspoken and very critical of the situation that's going on in the Middle East, and also essentially calling for a ceasefire. And it's the same thing all over again. But what I'm seeing now is that people are being, their careers are ending simply for statements. And I'm just like, it's shocking, and I feel like it's horrifying. You know, I think on one hand, you know, obviously a company has the right to hire and fire whoever they want. If they have an employee, you know, it's like the scenario of like, you know, say for instance, like I for a long time worked for a company for a while. Say that I worked for the YMCA for a long time. And, you know, if I had said something, more or less socially that was, you know, whether I was commenting on politics or religion or something, and it wasn't, say, the status quo opinion, and my boss came across it because we were friends on Facebook and decided to fire me because of that, because she didn't want to associate with me, you know, it's basically the same scenario, and that I represent the company to a degree. And so on one hand, it's like I am free, or these people in the media, these people that are going through this right now, these celebrities and actresses, they're free to speak however they want, you know, in public, and to express themselves in any way, shape, or form. And then also the companies, the same thing. If the companies see what they're saying and they don't want to associate themselves, they have the right to do what they do and terminate that person. And so it's not necessarily a question of free speech, but I kind of think it is, because of how dangerous it is that someone can get fired for it. So, and, you know, and I think also it's a thing of people should, that creates an environment over where people will essentially shut their mouths, which is inherently censorship, because out of fear, and fear of losing your livelihood, fear of losing your job. So that leans everything into this, to the area of, well, there is censorship. There is this way of where we're going to muzzle people because they are saying something that is quote unquote against the status quo. And obviously our narrative and what, you know, we are told by the majority of media outlets, what these people are saying is against the grain, is the thought from an individual and questioning. And I'm a firm believer in truth to power. You know, the truth is often very ugly and hideous, and people don't want to hear the truth most of the time, but you still have the right to say and to believe what you want. And I think to a degree, you know, people have the right to say that, especially if people are using social media, which is why they use social media anyway, and you have followers, is to express your opinions on certain things and trying to navigate through those things and trying to be respectful. But it's essentially what social media is. And to hopefully maybe even start conversations. But the idea of someone, you know, getting fired for making a statement and then being accused of being anti-Semitic and racist, to me, it's completely un-American, if anything. People want to wrap themselves in the American flag and say how great this country is, which I think it is, and that we have the right to speak. Well, when the common person looks at what's happening when people do speak their minds, whether there are whether they are people on the lower end of the totem pole or the top end of the totem pole of where they might have a few followers or, you know, a million followers, it doesn't really matter. That spreads this dark climate out to where people don't want to speak and won't speak because of fear of just speaking your mind, and that causes that's out of intimidation and fear of losing your livelihood. And to me, that is unpatriotic and un-American. I believe, if anything, the idea of someone expressing their opinions, we do live in a democracy, supposedly, but a democracy, you know, is the free will of the people and people being able to be at court and be able to express themselves freely, no matter who or what background they are from, whether it's they're from a different economic background or from a religious perspective or political persuasion. People are allowed to be in a space to where they can express themselves, and where there are many parts in the world where that is, you cannot express yourselves without facing jail time or worse. And that is our country, our democracy is messy, but we have that to where we have that freedom to do that. And now this has caused a climate of where everybody's got to, you know, just down center, please be quiet, and, you know, no, that's too controversial, you're that's not what everybody else is thinking, so don't say something that's going to counter that. It's causing this climate to where it is moving into territory of where it is censorship, and it is grossly un-American, because our democracy is there. And our freedoms are here, but it's messy, but we still have that, you know, we are lucky that we have this apparatus that we can, you know, talk and speak about our various different opinions on things. You know, we don't live under, you know, people who live in dictatorships, full-on dictatorships, or communist environments. Case in point, you know, people who are citizens in Saudi Arabia or people who live in China. I mean, those are the idea of thoughts are crimes into itself. That there isn't that safety of where people can just speak their thoughts and be able to express themselves. we do have that here, but now this has evolved to a situation. Now there is a climate of fear and apprehension that people can't just speak their thoughts. And then also just being a flat out accused of, you know, like these folks, who I'm mainly talking about, especially the Scream franchise and Susan Sarandon, being accused of being, you know, anti-Semitic. Like, that's a horrible claim, and that's a serious claim, and there is no truth to that. So I feel like it's very dangerous. It's very dangerous, and it's very dystopian, and it also is, it moves things into a state of where, it feels like you're moving into more of a fascist environment, and so it's very dangerous. And I think, you know, this whole situation spurred about this idea of, well, the situation with the Dixie Chicks, first and foremost. It made me think of that. But I think this situation is different because now it's all happening. There's multiple situations going on all at once. And there are people instantly being terminated. And so because there are multiple examples of this happening, it's creating this climate of where there's this dark cloud over our democracy and just over the state of where we are at. And I think that there's a darker thing. I don't think it's, on one hand, you do, like I said, you know, we do have the freedom to speak our minds, and companies or, say, our bosses, if they feel inclined, they can hire and fire whoever they want. They can work all those scenarios and do what they want. They have the freedom to do that also. You have the freedom to agree. You have the freedom to disagree. But it's a different state, I think, of when these aforementioned companies are accusing them of being flat out anti-Semitic, but then also taking actions that cause the complete loss of these people's lives, essentially. And on to the side of that, the reason too, I feel like it's also with these actions that have been happening, especially around the Scream franchise, you know, that is very telling of the kind of the narrative of what we're being told and the general agreement from, you know, or the opinions shared by all of these news networks, media networks. They are portraying a very narrow view of the conflict itself. And I think it's safe to say that the overall narrative of whether you are watching, say, you know, CBS News or CNN or Fox News, especially major media outlets that are, you know, in the homes of everyone's lives every day, the general consensus is that the most of the media is looking at this situation in Israel and Palestine as being for the most part, they are looking at things to a degree as black and white, and the overall narrative is where they are condemning and really vilifying the actions of the Palestinians, particularly Hamas. And the narrative is that the control narrative is that what Israel is doing is completely and utterly justified. And I feel like the narrative of what's going on is across the boards and across the spectrum. So for someone to come out and to be, you know, God forbid, like I said, the idea of truth to power, for somebody to come out and to individually make a statement of where you can be critical of the status quo, that is looked at as, you know, villainous. And that's essentially what happened. And I feel like if the narrative was different, and say the roles were reversed, or the scenario was a little bit, say in the other side of things, it perhaps would be different, but it's really not. It's really a question. Well, it's a culmination of, you know, the narrow vision and scope of how we are seeing this story. I mean, if you look at the history with Israel, I mean, they are one of our biggest trading partners in military weapons. Our economies are connected at the hip, and so they are a favored trading partner for us. There are billions and billions of dollars invested into Israel. So there is going to be a reluctancy to criticize anything or anything that they do, because of, when it comes down to it, it's money. And the same thing with, say, Saudi Arabia. Very, very rare, and if any, there's no critique, or there's no criticism of that country or how that country is run or its policies, because again, they are favored trading partners. And I think Israel is one of the biggest, and that is, they are one of our favorite, if not the most cherished business partners of the United States. So of course, the narrative to a degree is going to be a certain way. And so I think that is an indication, and I feel, you know, their money, their influence is really invested in our economy. So that casts a certain narrative through all businesses to a degree, with, you know, starting from the government to where it affects everything else. And it's, you know, it comes down to money. So, and, you know, on the other hand, too, I also feel whether or not a person, whatever their opinions are around this issue, I definitely believe, I'm a firm believer in truth to power, that to a degree, not that we are obligated, but I also feel part of us to a degree are, as citizens, to speak truth to power, to do the work, to do the research, to find out the truth, which is also most of the time very unsettling, but to use your democratic voice and to challenge the status quo. Because that, to me, when the powers that be are challenged, anything that is challenged in the society, it makes that society thrive and makes the society stronger, because that's the republic, that's the will of the people. And that's a muscle that needs to be flexed in our democracy, which isn't really being flexed. And people that do use that muscle, which I feel is patriotic, they are being reprimanded and they are losing their jobs for it. And it's not a question of whether you side with this group or you side with that group. It's the idea of converse and conversation and discussion. And that's what helps a democracy move along. And we're not that old of a country. And so, I mean, you look at societies like Greece or you know, in areas, other areas of the world where free discussions of various views were encouraged, and there was a freedom to really, really express yourself to all kinds of capacities, and we shouldn't ever forget that. It's very important, but I think where we are at now is particularly kind of dangerous. So I just wanted to do a video on this show. So Thanks again, and we will see you next time. Peace.